laws of math. So there can be another framework where that is true. Just like we have a Fibonacci count, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So that's an entirely different sequence that neglects certain numbers. There is no 4 in Fibonacci, mm-hmm. right? In the Fibonacci sequence. So in things that evolve in spiral, you don't even, those numbers don't even exist because mm-hmm. It's not a perfect sequence. Our system, a base 10 system, is an equidistant sequence where each number is the same distance from the last one, mm-hmm. right? But in other systems, and I believe he often tries to point out like how banking is used maliciously, you know, how they count decimals versus how they count cents. Mm-hmm. That's kind of what he points out to. But I believe one times one is one, because multiplication, all math, you can translate it into language. If I have one thing one time, you know, I have a one, it's only one thing one time. Right now, if I have two of these things, you know what I mean? So it doesn't, that's where he's confusing the language with the mathematics, which is easy to do, to be honest.
All right, indeed. And I'm gonna act like I'm Terrence Howard for a second, and I want to get your response. So the definition of multiply, just to touch on this one more time before we move on, human is to, and one of the definitions from dictionary.com is to increase or cause to increase greatly in number or quantity. Example, ever since I became a landlord, my troubles have multiplied tenfold. So I guess what he was saying, and once again, I'm not an engineer, but I guess what he was saying was, how can you increase something and get the same outcome? It's impossible to increase something because multiply means to increase. Mm-hmm. So he's saying, how can you increase something, but it remains the same? I guess that's the perspective he was looking at it from.
Because, again, he's multiplying something by itself first. So that's the first, right? If we're going to take things that literally, then we also have to obey the laws of our reality and physics. Because math is a language of our reality, right?
Yes.
Not the other way around. Our reality, we didn't build our reality from math. We discover math by studying our universe. And in our reality, two things of the same nature can't even exist in the same place at the same time. When you go into frequency, if I play a sound at the same frequency as my glass here, my cup of water, the glass is going to break. If you multiply by something, because they can exist, it's one times one, right? Mm-hmm. I am here, I'm one person. I can, now let's say if I wanted to make two of me, it would be me times two. It'd be me two times. Right. So it's never one in that equation. It's never one and one in that equation.
Indeed.
So although, you know, multiplication does mean that, that's why I say it's getting into the semantics and the language, getting caught mm-hmm. up in the language mm-hmm. too much, because math expresses reality.
Indeed. A word that was used a lot in the interview was hydrogen. I've heard people talk about hydrogen being the future, especially when with cars. A lot of people think that the electric vehicles, that phase is dying out, but in the future it's going to be all about hydrogen cars. Can you talk to us a little bit about this element? I don't know if that's the right word, element hydrogen, and why are people saying that's going to be the future of technology?
Well, so we've known since
people even drinking hydrogen water now and all that. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah. No, 100%. We've known since Oppenheimer, we can extract power from atoms, mm-hmm. right? So that's where we got the nuclear bomb, mm-hmm. The Manhattan Project. Mm-hmm. So, and for those who don't know, Einstein actually wrote and warned America, saying that Germany was very close to developing a nuclear bomb, and that if they did, there would be, you know, a big problem for the rest of the world, etc. So that's when I believe it was FDR commissioned $2 billion to do that, or $2 billion for the time. Like, just the amount was crazy. It was the largest military project in history for the time to develop the nuclear bomb. Now, I dove deep into that because when you see the results of a nuclear bomb, what was it, about 300,000 people dying in a few seconds, when we looked at Hiroshima, the atomic bomb dropping August 6, 1945. It's my birthday. Mm-hmm. And that was dropped over, like I said, Hiroshima. That's splitting an atom. That's the result you see just from cracking an atom open, pretty much. You see a nuclear bomb, an explosion. So that's how much energy you can extract from an atom. Mm-hmm. So it's about tapping into the atom and not using it to destroy the entire world, but converting that energy, because all energy can be converted, and using it for, yeah, cars, etc. Now, do I think it's going to be the future? It's about, like, you know, what we let happen. Tesla already proved in the late 1800s that we could have free energy if we wanted it. So It's not about, like, what's possible. It's really about what they allow.
You know. Right. No, definitely. Do you think the electric cars is dying out? Do you think in 10 years, 20 years, there won't be no more electric cars on the road? What you think? Because I'm seeing them at Tesla. I'm seeing that truck everywhere now. So I'm just curious what you think.
So that's when you get into capitalism, right? It's who gives us these things?
Yeah.
The same people making it, or are the people who will make the alternatives? So it's about whether or not they're going to destroy their investment or not. Mm-hmm. We're always 100 years behind in technology, and they milk what they can until, you know, they're ready to transition the institutions. We're looking at it with oil, fossil fuels. People are like bragging, certain politicians, they're fighting to, I'm going to bring back fossil fuels and get these jobs back. Mm-hmm. So they're not even thinking on the paradigm of free energy and saving the planet. There's still half of the, I can't even say half of the world, because these people are the minority, but you know what I mean? Half of our politics are involved with the capitalist aspect. So I don't think electric cars will fade. What usually happens is the first world countries develop these things. They get exported to third world countries, right? So we'll see them, you know, before they die out completely. A lot of companies here will start bringing them to other places and acting like they're doing charity work. But what they're doing is really just, again, getting the last of their investments before they send the next system over.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Shout out to KT. I see KT in the chat. Shout out to my brother KT.
I see people still asking about the multiplication thing. I think the simplest way I can put it, just for anybody still like unsure and on the fence, what is this finger, one time? What is this finger two times? That would be the equivalent of multiplication.
Okay.
Right.
It's a great way to put it.
One time is only one. Okay. Now, if I do this one time, seven times, then, you know, I have seven fingers.
Great way to put it.
Addition and multiplication are not the same thing.
School us on what's going on. You're behind the scenes. You know the latest developments with AI. A lot. It's moving so fast, human. I can't even keep up anymore. I mean, they just keep coming out with new models, new this, new that. They're on chat. Last year when we started, what version was ChatGPT on?
Well, it's just coming out. Me and KT actually dropped. We did the agriculture question, and we outperformed GPT Live on that.
And we on four in a year.
Yeah,
it's insane, bro. So school us on what's going on with technology. Where exactly we're at? Let us know what's going on.
So it's funny because, in a way, certain things have plateaued because GPT stands for general pre-trained transformers, right? Meaning they're just pre-trained on general information, and transformers is the model type. Now, what we're seeing, and I'm gonna get back to on how they plateaued. I'm gonna also touch on the developments and how everything moved fast. But what we're seeing is an amalgamation of different model types. Like I said, the computer vision models, other type of artificial intelligence models that were not large language models. They weren't chatbots. So most people were not familiar with them at all. So now when you deal with GPT-40 or GPT-4.0, you're asking a question to one website, but there's one model that's choosing which AI to send your question to. And then that AI is going to perform the task. So you're not talking to one model anymore. You're talking to a bunch of models. It's like a hybrid brain, a multitude of models. I've actually been working with this framework for a while now. So now it's really about how creative you can get with these different model types. So they, for instance, they have one that they were talking about. You can convert old handwriting from like the 1800s. If you just insert the picture and it'll convert it for you. Well, that's not a chatbot model. That would be a computer vision model, right? Like I explained earlier, something that uses a camera, pixels, the math of like an XY axis, numbers, you know, location, grid coordinates on a screen to perform calculations and then guess which letter each, you know, is written on the page, and then they convert it into text. So again, that's not a chatbot model. It's a different type of AI. So again, we're seeing them stack the back end, the under the hood, with a bunch of different AIs, which I think is normal. That's how we will develop better artificial intelligence. That's how I feel complex systems work. That's how the human body works. Everything that we go crazy about in AI, we have an organ for it. We have a cell for it, a neuron, you know, a cell type for it. And it works the same way, how they collaborate, how they work together. Now, on the speed, though, I'll attest to that as well. What we saw, the rapid growth of that, is we're exploring the age of compute. So first we, you know, back in the day, everything that you wanted to store or save or do on your computer, you had to do, had to be able to, you had to have the memory for it and the RAM for it, right? Mm-hmm. But now with cloud storage, we've had cloud for a while, right? For the better part of the last 20 years, we're able to perform crazy calculations like on a server somewhere else, right? I can train an AI on a Google computer on the other side of the world, on a supercomputer. So these GPUs, things like NVIDIA, if you're familiar, they started building these processing chips to allow high-end performance and mass calculation to process big data chunks. And the more that you can process, then the bigger the AI model that you can run. So what I mean is, like, every AI model that drops, you'll hear them talk about the parameters. So pay attention to that, right? They'll say 7 billion parameters, a trillion parameters. What they're talking about is like the neurons in the brain of that AI. And I use neurons because we actually use, we modeled the AI's, the algorithm after the human brain and how it processes information. So it goes through that network. Now, the more neurons you have, obviously the more processing power you have. So again, they started developing these chips to process all this stuff. And that's why NVIDIA, the company, their stock has gone through the roof. They keep going up because how well AI does will pretty much have a direct effect on how well NVIDIA does.
Indeed, indeed. So let me ask you this. Since you brought up NVIDIA and you're talking about computer chips, one of the things that I guess is not talked about a lot, but it's definitely talked about on the internet is different people are talking about, not just black people, all type people, all races talking about them using melanin in computer chips. And one of the things they talk about is melanin is this has this magnificent ability to transduce electrical energy. It's this amazing molecule that is the so people. Molecule. Yeah. So when black people hear that, black people are like, what they got niggas? They, you know, because you hear about the missing body parts and all of that. And the first thing we think is that so? So talk to me about the future, because we hear about melanin and cobalt from where's that area of the cobalt they're getting the cobalt from?
Congo.
Congo, yeah. Talk to me about melanin, and if they go crazy for cobalt like that in the Congo, we thinking what the hell will they do for melanin? So talk to me about melanin, this amazing molecule, and how it's going to play a role in the future with computer technology and computer chips.
Yeah. So first, melanin's a semiconductor. scientifically. We know that when we can research it. Like they don't even hide that. I mean, and the first thing that tripped me out is when I saw that they had it on spaceships. They begin making spaceships with melanin because how it can refract or, you know, absorbed ultraviolet light.
Right.
So now where they're getting it, that's, again, we know that they've done worse for less. So, yes. And I, whether, you know, mass producing it synthetically, I don't think so. You know, goes for, it's worth more than gold by the gram for a reason. Usually when you find a way to make something fake, it gets cheaper, right? Like diamonds, you know what I mean? Like certain crystals and minerals, when they find out how to make it artificially, becomes cheaper. So that it's worth more than gold by the gram. It's all suspicious, if you ask me. So, but yeah, it's properties. Again, it attests to how all technology is. If you want the best technology, you need to get it from nature. You have to look at the best in nature. But yeah, melanin, to touch on melanin a bit more and what I think about it, it's, if you look at the chemical, I advise people to do this too. Look at the chemical structure of melanin, all right? And then look up eumelanin. It's the melanin spelled with E-U, begin, and then melanin.
Yeah.
There's a type called pheomelanin, all right? Now, the melanin that we have, it's carbon-based, C18. And I bring that up because carbon is the most sharing, most giving, and most bonding element on the periodic table. Mm-hmm. It's, our Earth is carbon-based, right? We leave a carbon footprint. It's not conducive, but it's natural. Everything is carbon-based. So when we want to check how old something is, they'll even do carbon dating. So the way it interacts with the elements, it's in an organized manner. It's blocked for cooperation. It looks like a very cooperative structure. Now, when you look at pheomelanin, it's the complete opposite. It's nitrogen-based. And nitrogen is quite the opposite. You can see it in the structure. It's almost like destructive. It's non-symmetrical. Mm-hmm. And it takes, doesn't give, doesn't share. And I only bring that up just to express the idea of culture. If you really understand what I'm saying about people, our people and our cultures, sharing, cooperation, the way we adapt to everything, how we, you know, I'll leave it at that. I don't think I need to say much more on that, but
right.
The, what we can see in melanin microcosmically, what we can observe, how it can take energy from not just sunlight, from almost anything and convert it into, again, almost anything to make something out of nothing, so to speak. It attests to like the spiritual nature of our people and our greatness, whether it's in sports, whether it's mathematics, whatever we do. I think it directly reflects the alchemy of melanin.
Do you think if they, let's say melanin plays a huge role in computer chips in the future, do you think those who are heavily melanated, that will give them a special relationship with this technology? Like, we may be able to tap into this technology, like we're able to tap into the power of the sun at a more powerful rate.
Dang. You know, look, I think if you can think it, we can do it. It can be mathematically expressed, right? You just have to find how. That's the beauty of like the universe and the nature of God, is that it's all there. Like everything can be harmonized. Every idea can be engineered. Just at like what cost? You just got to figure out the mechanics of it. But what fascinated me immediately is the idea of like cyborg technology,
right? You know, right.
Biotechnology. Mm-hmm. So once we're dealing with, you know, say we're dealing with melanin integrated robotic arms and things like that, because what we do know is that the human body is very smart. It rejects things that it deems foreign. So whether there is synchronicity to be explored with biotechnology and how melanin is being integrated on a microchip level or even on a material level, like I expressed, they're doing spaceships and stuff like that. So again, with prosthetics, which I'm in favor of exploring prosthetics because I don't believe that we should fear all of these technologies. For instance, like a robotic arm, you need AI. The machine learning algorithms that go behind translating what your neurons are doing and all of those complex signals into movements and moving your fingers and articulating things, right? Mm-hmm. I'm not against that. So